Thank you. afternoon and welcome. The group you see behind me is the IUP Symphony Band, made of both music majors and non-music majors from all across our campus here at IUP. I just wanted to say welcome. I hope you enjoy our program. The first piece, Sea Songs, will be conducted by one of our graduate conducting assistants. So please welcome to the stage, Mr. David Ernest.
Thank you. I have to scooch down just a little bit. My name's Tim Paul. I'm the director of bands here. And it's a really cool thing today that's made possible by the Sims Foundation. And it was set up so that we could bring really special people in for our students to enjoy and the community to enjoy. And when it was my turn to do this, I started thinking, who do I bring that's going to have the most impact? And I thought, what are the qualifications? Good person, good human being, an idol in our field, someone who makes a difference every day of his life. And one name came to mind. It was Ray Cramer. So please help me welcome Ray Cramer to the podium.
It's been a real pleasure to be here. I taught for 36 years at the other Indiana University, but it's great to be here because I've always wondered where Indiana University, Pennsylvania was. And we found out this weekend, and it's been a great joy to be here and to spend time with these young people and with the colleagues and faculty members. The piece that I'm going to conduct is called Near Woodstock Town. Now, for those of you that are old enough to remember the other Woodstock that took place in this country many years ago, this is not that Woodstock. This is actually an Australian Woodstock town. And the composer, Percy Grainger, is perhaps one of the most famous composers for wind band that we know in our profession. He has such great pieces and great creativity and imagination going all the way back to 1905 when he first started putting together Lincolnshire Poesy, or there's Molly on the Shore, or there's Irish Tune from County Derry, or there's Shepherd Hay, or many, many other wonderful pieces that he has written for wind band. I was visiting the University of Western Australia one summer, and I was introduced to a gentleman by the name of Sir Frank Calloway. Frank Calloway was a personal friend of Percy Grainger, actually helped Grainger build the Grainger Museum in Melbourne, Australia. Because of that association that he had with Percy Grainger, he had his own personal collection at Western Australia University of Percy Grainger material. And he was allowing me to go through some of his files and pull out some manuscripts and letters and things that I had never seen or heard of before. And I felt like a kid in a candy store. And I came across this little vocal piece called Near Woodstock Town. And it was a little bit of a sea chanty, but not with so many tunes that you would expect. On most pieces like this, where the melody is basically the same, in the actual folk song tradition, there might be 200 verses to that particular melody. Today, I guarantee you there's not 200 verses. It's very short. But when I saw it, I thought, I would love to do a small arrangement of this for wind band. And he allowed me to make a copy and bring it home, and I set it to the wind band. The publisher, just to be funny, said on the score, dished up for wind band. Well, I didn't really like that, but I didn't have a choice. But anyway, here is the dished up version of Near Woodstock Town by Percy Grainger.
Thank you.
thanks again for joining us this afternoon. After this piece, we'll take a brief intermission as we reset the stage for the IUP Wind Ensemble. Thanks again. This last piece is called Symphonic Dance Number 1. Please enjoy. Thank you.
One of the really nice things about having Mr. Cramer here is having the opportunity to see things done differently. And we normally tune the band in a little bit different fashion, but when he's working with the band, he tunes the band differently. And I thought for all the band directors who are out in Pennsylvania could learn and see a different way of tuning would be wonderful. And plus, you'll get to hear priorities of sound and how all of that works. And so I'm going to have him come out and do that. And then I'll come out and conduct. And the first piece I'm going to conduct is La Procession de Rocio, which was premiered in 1913 in Madrid. And Joaquin Turin did this. And that's actually what made him famous. And then he went back to his hometown. And it's in the style of almost what we would call a Mardi Gras. So lots of things, but there's some little religious connotations with it. And he was influenced by the Impressionism of Debussy. And so we'll see if we hear some of that in the music. But for now, we'll go ahead and start. And before I bring him out, I'm going to say one thing. Mr. Cramer asked me not to put the long bio in the program. I put it in there purposefully. Not to make him mad. And not to give you reading information. But I put that in there so you can see the life and career of someone so special that would take time and come see us. And if it could be done, he has done that, and he's doing this now. So please welcome him to the podium.
Thank you.
I Wake in the Dark and Remember was just written and became available in December. And when I heard this, I contacted Flory and I said, wait till you hear this. We have to do it. I sent it, I pushed send, and within about 30 seconds, she said, yes, we have to do it. And this was back in December before it was available. It was available, we have it. I think it's important that I read a little bit to you now, so it's kind of story time for a second. But it says, W.S. Merwin's poetry has been a constant in my life, and this is Joel Puckett speaking. Actually, me speaking, but his words. His words bring me comfort in times of anxiety, smiles in times of happiness, and comfort in times of grief. In 2021, brought difficult times for all of us, and I once again found myself turning to Merwin's words. I rarely know exactly what his poetry means, but I love how they make me feel. This was no different for the poem that inspired my viola concerto, which I only know of one, he's not writing this, I only know of one other viola concerto with wind ensemble. So this is a welcomed addition to our repertoire. It says, I wake in the dark and remember. As I was writing, I rolled over the imagery in my mind. Wake in the dark and remember. Listening to the black hour. You were sleeping beside me while around us the trees full of night lean, et cetera, et cetera. These images are so vivid and clear that they lack any strict narrative. So my imagination became free and ran wild just to see what sounds and words inspire. The concerto is in two movements but played without a break. In the Dark, I Wake in the Dark and Remember was commissioned by an international consortium of universities led by Damon Talley at Louisiana State University. This is the poem that it is based on. I wake in the dark and remember. It is morning when I must start by myself on the journey. I lie listening to the black hour. It's before dawn and you are still asleep by me while around us the trees of night lean, hushed in the dreams that bears us up asleep and awake. Then I hear drops falling one by one into the slight sightless leaves, and I do not know when they began, but all at once there was no sound but rain, and the streams below us roaring away the rushing darkness. The remainder of the program is going to take place with Mr. Cramer conducting. I will let him talk about the pieces with you. We're going to tune for a second, get back centered, and then we're going to keep playing music. I hope you're enjoying it as much as we are. We'll tune and be back in a second.
I wanted to just say a word about the next piece before we play it. One Life Beautiful was a commissioned work by my wife and I, our son and his family, and Heather's husband and children. She was tragically taken from this earth while she was on a training ride on her bicycle for an upcoming triathlon. No one ever likes to have that happen in their life. All of us lose ones that we love in our life. It's inevitable. But no parent is ever prepared to lose their children before they pass away. Heather was a very special person to us, but also to the people that knew her. And so this piece was commissioned to honor her memory for years to come. The composer, I think, writes a very compelling, very short program note about this piece that I would like to read. First of all, the composer was a very dear friend of ours, and when it came time to ask some composer to write this commission, we did not have any doubt that we wanted Julie to write this piece. I'm not going to go into the story about how this piece came about, except to give you this brief explanation. She usually composes all of her work on electronic keyboard. When she was working on this work, all the power went off in her house because of a terrible thunderstorm that was taking place in the area. It didn't come back on, so she went over to her acoustic piano and sat down and started noodling around on the keys because she had already called us and told us what a difficult time she was having in putting this piece together. She said, as I sat there at the keyboard and playing some chords and some various melodies, all of a sudden, this melody came to me. And she said, all of a sudden, the entire piece, in minutes, fell into place. She was convinced that that melody was sent to her by my daughter. There is a Heather melody. You don't hear it until the 30th measure. And then you'll hear it repeated several times in different instruments. But you will recognize it when it happens. This is what Julie wrote. One Life Beautiful. The title itself is a double entendre, which in one sense is referring to the person this work is dedicated to, as in one life that was beautifully lived. The other sense is a direct observation concluding that having only one life is what makes life so sacred, tragic, and so very precious. This is an impressionistic work musically describing that condition, Shakespeare's sweet sorrow, the frailty and strength of life the meaning of what it is to truly live one life. Beautiful. Well, they're changing for this last number. These people are so talented. I look around and they're always playing different instruments and moving around like I can only manage one instrument at a time, and that wasn't always great. But I thank them for their talent. And I want to just say that the few days that I've been here and spent with these students in both ensembles have just been a great experience. They're so polite, so cooperative, so talented, and so dedicated to what they're doing, because that's what they're gleaning from the people that stand in front of them, their two directors. I have known Dr. Paul for many years. I first met him in 1997 when he brought his really outstanding Leon High School band from Florida to play at the Midwest Clinic in Chicago. We have been friends off and on as we see each other at conventions for many, many years. And I've always appreciated the way that he treats his students, the way that he inspires them, the way he motivates them, and the most important, the way that he loves his students. And I think that you can see that they respond to him wanting to reciprocate that same kind of connection that is so important in music making. So I'd like to have you join me in thanking Dr. Paul and Zach and the fantastic soloists and these students for just the joy that my wife and I have had for the last few days of being in Indiana University, Pennsylvania. Thank you very much. And now to end the concert on a little bit lighter note, and we've had a couple of very somber and very powerful and meaningful works in the last two that you've heard. But we'd like to close with a piece that I arranged several years ago for my own students, just so we could have some fun and show off the abilities of the ensemble and just enjoy the great music of Tchaikovsky. So here is Dance of the Jesters.